linear model in application of that, so that you can get best of that model or what we call it methodology. So that one is my intention, and I need help from your side that do practice a lot, and if you do practice, definitely you will come across several problems, and let me know those problems. I will try to rectify those. Okay, so here today we'll talk about a specific kind of linear model. One is a linear regression, another one would be polynomial regression. So linear is simpler one, and polynomial is little bit complex than linear regression. That is the so very specific kind of model that we are taking. Later I will talk about classification problem as a linear model as well. So right now few classes would be based on regression model. That means what is the difference between regression and classification? In regression, the response happens to be continuum in nature. That means it is a continuous variable. This random variable is generally happens to be continuous in nature. Simply we say that continuous in nature. And what about classification problem? A classification problem that happens to be that y happens to be discrete in nature, that value y taking a discrete fashion. So that is the difference between regression problem and continuous problem. So for both kind of problem you can model with the help of linear model. Modeling can do with the help of linear. So it is just implied to regression. If you take y is a continuous random variable, if you talk from probabilistic perspective, I told that probabilistic approach is the best approach and robust approach to model any problem that you want to learn from the data. So that is the best approach, that if you go through probabilistic, because you will have a robustness. You can calculate error, you can calculate everything, approximation, what is the performance of model, and every tools is provided by probability. So go for that probabilistic approach. So I will first talk about here content of this lecture. First I would like to discuss about least square estimation of a response. It would be recap that in last class I had already discussed. So and till last class it was pure theoretical. Now here we will talk about linear regression. It becomes an applied version that you are going to apply directly to some problem of what in your interest, where you want to apply. It depends upon if that problem is very much suitable to linear regression, then we will do linear regression. If it is not linear regression is not giving a better fit, then we will look for polynomial regression. The polynomial is little bit complex than linear regression. That is, so all these are what explicit model directly in Python. If you try to apply it, you will get a well set library for these things, and easily you can apply those. But theory behind those you need to understand, and that is already based on what we call it linear model approach, that general theory what I had already discussed. So coming to recap of the multiple univariate linear model, so you had already seen that always what we do, we try to y the response, and we try to approximate to y, we try to estimate y by using conditional expectation. So conditional expectation is, it is what we are saying, that it is one estimate of hypothesis function. Y will have various hypothesis function. Among those, under the least square method, this conditional expectation is the best estimate of the hypothesis function, that through that we try to observe the dependency of y over x. So that means it would be what, it would be function of x, dependency of y over x. That means x is the dependent variable and x is the independent variable and y is the dependent variable. So why we do that? So it is problem of learning. So what is the ultimate goal of learning? That at hand we are having x and we are having y, few value of x and few value of y. Okay, and we try to apply some kind of criterion function. L is the criterion function that measure the difference between these two. That means difference between hypothesis function and what we call it the given data value y. After that, there would be various loss with respect to several sample. various laws. So you have to find the average. And suppose you know the distribution of x and distribution of y. If you know the distribution of x, then easily you can know the distribution of above x as well. So if everything is known to you, that direct approach, find the representation of those loss function. The x is taking various value, y is taking various value. That means your sample size is very definitely sample size. It is more than one. So what you do? Definitely you need to go for representation of that. That representation is coming from what? Expectation or mean. So we are defining mean of this loss of loss between hypothesis function and what y. So after that, what we do? Do here f would be very. There are various options of f. There would be various hypothesis function. So we try to find the best hypothesis function. How we can find? By minimizing this expected loss. This we are calling it expected loss. By minimizing the expected loss, then we will get the best hypothesis function that we denote it by f cap. This one is the general goal of a linear problem. Generally, every linear learning problem, what we do, always we try to learn a function. But there is a problem. This one is a highly complex problem. Highly complex because you don't know the explicit structure of f. You don't know. So what you have to do? So you have to go for a simple approach, practical approach, in place of what we do, direct finding the expectation of the loss, expected loss between hypothesis function and y, you can find an empirical loss. That one is the practical approach because at hand you are having n number of data. So here xi is the attribute, yi is the output or response. So you are having how many? N. So this is the data set given to you of sample size, or this is the sample of size n is given to you. N observations, you can call it n observation, a single observation sample with n observation, or n data points, simply you can say n data point is given to you. From that n number of data points, you try to infer about hypothesis function. So that means definitely it becomes a very simple kind of things. So once you are having a data point, n number of data point, and there is nothing mentioned, so always what happens, we always say that it is what, discrete in nature. This n number of data points are discrete in nature. So if no assumption, no distribution of those data points is given, because distribution, why it would be given? It is the distribution is ultimately you want to learn. That model you want to learn from which that this data point has been sourced out, and you don't know that. If you don't know, then definitely how you can proceed with distribution? So simplest distribution would be the what? Uniform distribution. That means each point is equally likely. How many points we are observing? We are observing n number of points. So that's where joint distribution of x and y, it would be 1 by n. That uniform law, it is directly coming from uniform law. This is the density or probability mass function. These are discrete, so probability mass function of this one is 1 by n. Simple, it is coming from uniform law principle. So that's way here you are having n number of points, and you are defining some criterion function as, that means L2 norm, L3 norm, L4 norm, whatever you want to do. So here this expected loss, easily you can calculate as an average, because uniform distribution, your density you have taken 1 by n, so it will come out from that sum, and only you are summing all the loss with respect to each data point. And here what is happening, 1 by n is the what we call it joint distribution, you know that due to equally likely assumption. And here hypothesis function also we have parameterized. The dependency of x, the dependency of y over x, how we measure it? So here we simplify it, saying that we are taking a parametric form, that f, we are not taking any general class kind of things. So we parameterize f of x like this way. That means either it may be a linear. So here very simple case we are taking, that linear. Suppose f is defined by parameter omega naught plus omega naught and omega 1, and f of x equal to what, omega naught plus omega 1. So that's way this approach we are calling it parameterization. Or if you are from EC, then you will call it, whether you are from EC or CSE, name of this one is, we are saying that we are giving a model structure. So this model structure is what? Linear model structure. This modular structure word, definitely it would be common to both EC and CSE student. In some of the courses you will come to know. So this we are calling it modular structure. So this function is linear, having this function is having linear modular structure. So that is the thing we are defining in general case in this linear, in this course. Okay, and what we do, again we minimize and we are finding the argument, that function. So finding the function is equivalent to finding the estimate value of omega naught and omega 1, that parameter, that in that case it becomes, when you do parameterization, the approach of finding an estimated hypothesis function becomes parameter estimation. So that's way we are doing. So this one is a practical approach that you can do it. It is a feasible problem. Usually you can do it through uniform law of principle. So that's why I have already mentioned here, it is involving sample size n, that number, n number of observations we had taken. So n is what? Natural number. Generally we count sample, one sample, two sample, three sample, four sample, sample point kind of thing. So it is always what? It is always inductive in nature. So you can just apply this principle of induction here, and with the help of that law of large number, to approximate the hypothesis function by applying some kind of criterion function, that we call it loss function. So just you can say that this one is giving what an approximation of the expected loss. This is the expected loss, and we are it is giving an approximation. This quantity is giving approximation of that. So that we can say that definitely if you do approximation, so you have to do all those efficiency, consistency, that you are getting estimate, then you have to perform all those things that I had already mentioned that. So that's where these are the general goal of any learning problem, irrespective of your branch, any. So in general perspective I am talking about. So that's where I put it in recap. So here always what we say, this quantity is a practical thing, practical you can do, and this one is giving what expectation of the measure, one approximation of true expectation of the loss function. Okay, loss function, that loss between hypothesis and y. Okay, so that is the criteria. Now coming to estimating parameter in multiple I will talk about here multiple univariant. In last class I discussed about that. Multiple univariate linear model. So we had already seen the assumption of error. So the expectation of error, that means overall error may come from rightward, leftward, but overall error always zero. That means mean of the error is always zero, and the error is always independent of what we call it input variable or attribute. That won't be so that thing we had already discussed. Through that assumption we had already seen that estimate of what the parameter, it was what we are coming it through this matrix X was bold, X was what data matrix in the model, Y equal to with various attribute we had plus epsilon was the error. From here we had derived one solution of omega, estimate omega by this formula, and we had already told that this one happens to be unbiased. If you find the expectation of this one, it would be equal to the true value of the parameter. Omega cap is the estimated value and omega is the true value. So if you find the expectation, it would be true value of this one, and due to that law of large number, and hence we are calling this estimate of for this linear model happens to be unbiased estimator. And also if you are estimating one, we are getting one estimator of the omega parameter omega, we have to talk about further properties. One property that we have to talk about that we got the expectation of the estimator, that one is equal to omega. Okay, so then what is the variance? We need to calculate the variance as well, and also we have to find the error. So this is the error, second term is error, First one is expectation we got. So we got the prediction error or estimation error. Here prediction and estimation both are same. Sometimes people are calling it this conditional expectation of y given as a prediction function. Sometimes we are calling it estimation function. Sometimes we are calling it regression function. So all three name are common to it signify the same. Okay, so it is a regression function or prediction function. So you can call it the difference between estimator and the true value. We are calling it prediction error or estimation error or whatever situation. If you just dealing with the data itself, then it is estimation error. If you are trying to predict for given attribute at your hand, you try to predict the value of y, then it becomes a prediction error. So depends on the situation what you want to proceed with. So again, the prediction error can be expressed in term of like this way, this term. Okay, and then third term was, if it is this one is an estimator, it happens to be a random variable, then what is the variance? So variance we can calculate it here. What this estimator, it is a vector, so it is not a single number now, it is a vector, it is not univariate, omega is not univariate, it is depends upon dimension, n dimension, something like that. So we need to find the covariance matrix or variance covariance matrix. That would be also expressed in the term of data matrix times variance of the error. Sigma square is what? It is the variance of sigma square is always, because we always take assumption that total error is always happens to be Gaussian in nature. So always we can proceed with that one variance, we can take it. So if you here variance of sigma epsilon is that error term is equal to sigma square. So sigma square is coming. Either what is happening, either it would be given in the problem one source, or you have to estimate it. Either it would be given or you have to estimate. So if you want to estimate, then one estimator of the variance, we know that we get it from the sample variance, that you can get it for a sample variance regarding the error. Okay, and a few more assumption you will see it here. Now I am directly coming to main part of this lecture, that one is talking about linear regression. So what is linear regression? So anyone have gone through linear regression till now in some of the course? Anyone say something, want to comment? Anyone have you seen linear regression anywhere? Because it is a very genuine question. Why am I studying linear regression regression again? If some of courses has already covered that, then that question definitely it will come here. I would like to answer that. Anyone just comment over that? Anyone has gone through linear regression in any of the course? No. That means first time you are seeing linear regression. Okay, very fine. So linear regression is what? It is a linear model. This is the simplest linear model, what we are calling it. The simplest linear model for regression is one that involves a linear combination of input variable, or attribute. Input variable generally we denote it by attribute. So you are having attribute. That generally we denote it by x. And what another response or output that we denote it by y. So the relation, the association between x and y, it would be here linear in the linear regression. We denote it by, and we will have a linear relation between these two. So in that case, so the linear model which exhibit linear relation between these two variable, that we are calling it a linear regression. Linear relation, we will see it here. Okay, so it is coming like this way. So suppose we are having n number of attribute, x1, x2, x3, up to xn, and we are having single response y, and we try to find the relation between x and y through linear function. So this function is what? If you try to see this simply you can say that it is your hypothesis prediction function or estimation function or hypothesis function, estimate of hypothesis function. That means if conditional expectation of y given x, this is okay. So what you observe here? Here you observe that your hypothesis function is linear in your input or attribute. It is linear in simply you can say that like linear in x and also linear in parameter omega. So it is a linear function and linear association. That means your model structure is linear. So here write like this way, model structure is linear, that hypothesis function you have taken linear, and the association between dependent and independent variable is also linear. So both are linear. So that's why we are calling it linear regression. It is what? Model structure is linear and it is association is also linear, the relation is also linear with respect to argument or attribute x. Okay. Now so this is the a specific form of linear regression. So we can get a compact representation of this multiple linear regression. There are multiple attributes, that's why you can call it multiple linear regression. So you can get a call a compact representation in term of dot product of x with I. X is a vector here, x is a, or omega is a vector plus error term. This is the error term. Okay. So here x is what? It is having n plus 1 component. X naught is the component with respect to omega naught. We are trying to give a compact representation. And x1, x2, xn. That means x is containing x naught along with n attribute. N plus 1 component. X is having n plus 1 component in which x naught is known to us. That one is equal to 1. And omega is containing n plus 1 parameter. Omega is n plus 1 parameter. So in total dimension of this one is n plus 1. Dimension of x is n plus 1. So we are getting a vector representation of dot product representation of this linear regression model. Now what we do? So we can observe it here. If this function, it is a dot product between x and y. So dot product is always bilinear. If you are defining dot product between any two vector, how we define it? So one definition I told that it defines it through this way. Dot product of this, there are various ways to define dot product. Then simplest, that one is coming with respect to what we call it, this one is L2 approach to define dot product between any two vector, or simplest one that you in high school you have already seen. This is the same dot product. This one is coming with respect to dot product, and in simple you can write it just to signify your dot product experience in high school. You can write it x dot y, you can read it x dot y. So this one is this inner product, general name is inner product. This one is coming with respect to dot product. Okay, this one is coming with respect to dot product. This inner product is coming with respect to dot product. Simply we are calling it like this way. So if you see that, so dot product is always it is linear, bilinear. That means linear with respect to first argument, also it is linear with respect to second argument. So here first argument is what? It is your attribute, and second argument is the parameter. And we know that dot product is also commutative. That means x dot y is equal to y dot x. So there is no specific order in case of dot product. Commutative law is followed. So it is equal to like this way. So so that's why further we see that it is, that's why we are saying that it is a linear function of the parameter omega, and also it is a linear function of the attribute x. So this signifies limitation. So due to this, this one is the simplest model, and it is not giving a good fit of the y. It is not giving a good fit. There would be limitation. So we have to look for alternative approach. So what does that come? So we therefore extend the class of model by considering feature map. Feature map in model one, remember that how to capture nonentity through basis function that I had already discussed. So another name of basis function we are calling it feature map. So we have to consider few specific feature map or basis functions of input variable or attribute, because this one is having limitation. This linear regression is having limitation. It is not giving a good fit. It is not giving a good fit of y, that response. So we have to go for some feature map. So before going to some feature map, simplest one is the polynomial basis function that we had taken. And before going to that, I will take one example. After that, I will talk about polynomial regression. If you are taking basis function as a polynomial, then corresponding regression name would be polynomial regression. If you are taking basis function as radial, then your regression would be what? Radial regression. If you are taking basis function spline, then it would be a spline regression. Just name is changing with respect to basis, it signifies. Don't call it, all these are linear model. There is no nullity till now. So one example we are taking it, that we will try to perform here simple linear, it's not a simple, multiple linear regression, we will perform it here. So consider a response with bivariate observations. So we are having bivariate or bivariate attribute. Simply call it bivariate. I just make unique input to our attribute. That means we are having two attributes. We go for after that. We, that means two means multiple attribute. So multiple univariate model. So and this is coming as a in the linear. We are going for linear approximation. So omega naught plus omega 1 times x1 plus omega 2 times x2. So omega 1 is the coefficient or parameter with respect to first argument, omega 2 is the parameter with respect to second argument. So overall we can express this one x times omega. So x is what? It becomes what? Data matrix, and first component would be 1 1 1, second component will come with respect to first observation or first attribute, as third column will, of this data matrix would come from second attribute x2. So just this simply again further compact notation in the form of matrix, and omega is the vector having first component omega naught and second component omega 1, third component omega 2. So like this way, this is the representation all about. So here data is coming like this way. We have taken a sample of size n, that means 12 observation we have taken. We are taking 12 observation, 1, 2, 3, you can see it like this way. And these are the x, that first attribute is taking these 12 value. 0, 2, 2, 2, 2, 4, 4, 4, 4, 6, 6, 6, 6, 8, 8, 8, like this way. Okay, and second attribute, it is taking value like this way. You can say that, you can relate it with previous model, that you can say that it is the, these marks are related to first homework, these marks are related to second homework, and these are the midterm marks. That means only two homework have been assigned to you prior to midterm. So you are taking that kind of approach. So that's where definitely if two homework are assigned prior to midterm, so definitely there would be two attributes, first homework and second homework. This one is with respect to first and this one with respect to second, and this one is the marks you got in midterm. So these are the, and what I haven't taken all the student of the class, just I have randomly sampled 12 students from the class, because a student here are more than 12, it is not 12, more than 12. So only 12 student I have taken. So that's why you can say that it is a sample of size 12 is given. A sample of size 12 is given. It is not a population. It is not talking about population complete class. Okay. Now we will do a linear fit of y with respect to these two. That means y as a linear function, it would be linear with respect to x1, x2 attribute, also linear with respect to as a linear that model, that linear, it would be linear model, that will linear with respect to omega, the parameter as well. So in order to do that, so we have to express x1 as the first column, second column of the data matrix, one first column would be what? It 1 1 1 1, it is coming corresponding to omega naught, the coefficient omega naught or the parameter omega naught. So 1 1 1 1 is coming with respect to that one. So by default x naught, what I had already told that. And second column is coming with respect to first attribute, and third column is coming with respect to second attribute. So overall you are having this data matrix, and you are having, this is the response vector. This one is with respect to first sample. This one is second sample with his second sample. This one is with respect to fourth sample point. Likewise, this one with respect to 14th sample. Actually, more number of data is coming, I think. No, there is no issue. It is not talking about number of counts, number of sample size. So that 14 is the value of the 12th student. 12 midterm marks of the 12th student. Okay, so that is the given here. And overall, directly you can construct from the data matrix, you can construct X transpose X. And what is the size of this matrix, data matrix, size of this data matrix, how many observation you are having, how many sample sizes you are having, 12. And how many attribute you are having, two attribute additional one coming with respect to omega naught. So the size of data matrix would be 12 by 3. And this size, the response vector, it is always given by the sample size, that one is 12. So response vector, it is a 12 by 1 vector, 12 dimensional vector. And using this matrix, you can construct X transpose X. So it would be just 3 by 3 sizes. You can see that easily, you can calculate. So your computation becomes simple if you are putting in the matrix notation. And using this, what would be the solution of that estimated value of omega? Anyone can say that? What would be that? Several times I had given formula. What is value of estimated value of omega? It is dealing with one sample. So one estimate of omega, there would be several estimate. It would be because you can take several sample of size 12, because there are many students, you can form various sample of size 12. So one sample of size 12, I have taken it here. So one estimate of omega I will get. You can go with another sample of size 12. So in that case, you will get another estimate of omega. So what would be the estimate of omega? Anyone just recall the formula. What is that? It says that omega estimate, we can get it as X transpose, inverse of X transpose X into X transpose into Y. So through this, you can get estimate, one estimate of omega, that we just everything here, X is known to you, that data matrix is known to you, the response vector is known to you. So what you can get the one estimate of omega, and that is given by this formula. It is what? It is a three-dimensional vector and taking value of this one. So you got the what? You got the estimate one. This one is you got a linear regression for this problem. You got a linear fit. Simply we can call it linear fit. You got a linear fit. That is the ultimate job of this problem. Now we'll talk about another thing is that polynomial regression. So before going to polynomial regression, I'm talking about generalization perspective. So linear regression is not giving a better fit. So we have to generalize it. That means we have to what go to feature space. That state space is not possible. So the space constructed by attribute or feature, we are calling it a state space. That means in the last case, you had taken two attribute or two state. It was X1 was the first homework mark, X2 was the second homework mark, that we are calling it. So it is a two state situation. Two state situation, two dimensional or two state situation. There are only two state. Now, from the two state is not giving a better fit of the data. So what we have to do, we have to apply some kind of feature map phi to translate or transform this one into high dimensional feature space. So here various, so again this one will come with respect to first base. Suppose we are taking three basis function, phi 1, it will come with respect to phi 1 of x. This one will come with respect to phi 2 f x, and this one will come with respect to phi 3 of x. So third, so we can see that here we have transformed the two state space, two dimensional state space into three dimensional feature space. So in short, I am writing it feature space. Also, this state space, you can call it input space. Input space, a state space, all are same name. A state space, all are, and you can convert the transform that using some feature map or basis function, you can transform into feature map. So that we will do it here for generalization. So consider a linear model as a linear combination of fixed nonlinear function of the input or attribute of the form like this way. So you can observe that here linear model we are taking like the directly attribute is not coming. In place of attribute, what we observe function of those attribute. So function of those attributes. So omega 1 times function of x, first function of x, first that basis function, this one is second basis function, likewise n basis function we have taken. So x is coming with respect to a state space or input space. X is the input, it may be simple, it may be multiple, depends upon what choice is there. So further we can apply the compact notation of this one as a dot product or inner product of the basis function. This phi is what vectorized. It is having n component, phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, up to phi n. All these are the component of this phi. So we can put in the vector form. So all these are just notation convention and not more than that. So through this, what we observe that here phi of x is defined as first component is phi naught of x. So first component would be phi naught of x with the, in order to cover this bias term as well. So this we generally we are calling bias term or constant term. So by phi naught of x would be equal to 1 in order to that that basis function associated with bias term it would be 1 and other are just function of feature map. Function of feature map. And here parameter omega is what? Having n plus 1 component. That omega naught is coming with respect to bias and rest n component that coming with respect to those basis feature map what you are defining. So this is the story of this basis linear model with general basis function or feature map. So in many practical application of learning model we apply some form of fixed pre-processing or feature what we call it feature extraction to the original model. So same that defining feature map we are talking that we do perform feature extraction or we are performing pre-processing of the data because lower dimensional input space fails sometimes, say most of time fails to capture the actual relation between y and x. It fails to because the dependency might be very complex and that means it is not linear. It may be non-linear. So linear regression fails. So you have to look for some kind of basis approach. Basis representation. That means nonlinearity is there, so you have to apply some nonlinear function as a basis. So that's where you are doing that. Okay, so if the original variable comprise the attribute x, then the feature can be expressed in the term of basis function phi j of x. Phi j of x. So feature map you are introducing. So one simplest feature map that we are taking is polynomial. So what we do here phi j of x we are defining as a polynomial. That means we are suppose we are having a single attribute like this way, then what would be that phi j? It would be x to the power j. That means x to the power j varies from 0 to n or 0 to d, what dimension you want, what dimension of the feature space you want, you can go up to that. So suppose you want to vary up to d, so you will get a monomial like this way. X to the power 0 is what? 1. X to the power 1 is x. X to the power 2 is x square. That quadratic term. X to the power 3 is x cube. X to the power d is. So here what will happen is that your linear model would be a d-dimensional polynomial in attribute x. So again, in that case, your polynomial regression, it is nonlinear in attribute or input variable, but linear in parameter. That means the structure is linear. Model structure. So here we are talking about polynomial regression. So by using nonlinear basis function, we allow the prediction function, that conditional expectation of y given x, w also I am bringing it because we are parameterizing it to be a nonlinear function of the input vector or input attribute x. It would be nonlinear function, and here this prediction function would be linear only with respect to that omega, and it will have nonlinear feature with respect to attribute. So however, it is a linear model because this function is linear in omega, and it is what? It is linearity in the parameter that will greatly simplify. Why we are taking linearity with respect to parameter? Because it is very simple to proceed with that estimation technique. So that's why we are taking a linear. If you go for nonlinear, then things would be very complex. So that's why we are taking it. So in a polynomial regression, we are considering a single input. Suppose we are taking a single, for simplicity, we are taking a single attribute x, and the basis function we are defining it through monomials, the x to the power j. So first basis function would be x to the power 0, second would be x to the power 1, third would be x to the power. So from that perspective, our model would be what? What would be our model? It is not given here. Our model would be something like this. Y equal to prediction function plus error. So our model would be like this way, omega naught, and the basis function we have taken it, phi j of x equal to x to the power 0, and suppose we are having only one attribute, we are not having more than one attribute. So simple situation, we have taken j varies from 1 to d, depends upon. So here our model would be omega naught plus omega 1 time x to the power 1 plus omega 2 to the power x square. So you are getting a d degree hypothesis function, or d degree that prediction function, what we are calling it, omega d to the power x to the power plus that prediction error. That's why we are writing here equal. If just you are taking this one only, you are not taking prediction error, in that case approximation would come. So that's why error term is coming. This is your linear model for polynomial regression with single attribute. But what is happening, if you try to focus on this one, so this model we are not doing in the with respect to single attribute, we are doing in the feature space, d-dimensional feature space. So we are performing this modeling in d-dimensional feature space, where in d-dimensional feature space this one is nonlinear, but if you look in the actual dimension, it is nonlinear, but in d-dimensional it is linear. So polynomial regression here I will talk about. Consider that we are having m number of observation of the data. That means we are having n number of data points. That means we are having a sample size of m. Then for ith sample, we are having the regression model like this way. Yi equal to omega naught plus omega 1 times xi plus omega 2 times xi square plus likewise omega d times xi d square, plus error term is coming. I told that this one is what always it is talking about estimation of y, that's why we are taking error. And here sample size varying from 1 to m, so there are m number of sample we have taken. So if you I have taken this one, this example, that suppose you are fixing your d equal to 4, that means you are having data of wage versus age. That means wage, that daily wage or whatever you can take it. So these are the data, you can do a scattering plot. These are coming with respect to a scattering plot. Here we try to model it through that polynomial regression. So if you try to model it through linear regression, and then it would be not a good fit. Linear regression directly it will give this fit, like this way. It is not giving, not covering in this data. It is very bad. It is giving in what it is doing, underfitting. So very bad for this kind of x, this kind of attribute. Age is here attribute, and wage is the response. Okay, so for these ages or this value of attributes, you want to get that this linear model is just underfitting that. So you have to go for better fit. Better fit, how you will get, you have to introduce some kind of basis function. That we are here introducing basis function, that polynomial function phi of g equal to x to the power g. And what degree we are taking it here? So degree always what it is coming from your the approach of a scattering plot of the data, and from that you can just take degree of your choice, what you want to go. You can go for degree 2, then you will see that your prediction error is large. You can go for degree 4. Always what you can see that here the concavity is what it is not odd, it is even in nature. So better go for always even degree, even degree kind of approximation of this this data. Okay, so here if you what do afterward, this second plot is talking about what it is plot with respect to prediction function, what we are calling it prediction function with respect to wages, and this is a plot with versus wage versus wage versus age. This is for prediction, and when in this situation situation is very bad. Here you can observe that the situation is very bad when wage is taking value 250 onward. There you observe two clustering. One cluster is coming here, another cluster is coming here. So two type of clustering in total you observe. So that's why situation is very bad. For that situation, for very bad situation, this model is again not good. You have to go for further model. That I will talk later. So limitation, it will go on. Limitation, there would be various limitation. There is one more limitation, is that volumetric function is what? It is global in nature. That means here it is x is not taking value locally. So at one point, if you're changing the value of attribute, then it will affect other point as well. So that's why this more again in this polynomial regression is having limitation. So another regression that we will talk about spline regression. So a spline is talking about that one is also in polynomial category, but there is a benefit that a spline is defined as localized in localized way. That means piecewise polynomial. You can say that a spline are what? Those are piecewise polynomial. Piecewise polynomial approach. So in that case, that one is giving local approach, local to measure the local dependency of y over x. So that's why spline regression is more robust than polynomial regression. That we will see it. Okay, regarding attendance, just go and